It's time for your Lowcountry Real Estate Market Update. It's the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show. Brian is one of the top 1% real estate agents in Charleston. Find him online at listingsincharleston.com. That's listingsincharleston.com. Or call him at 843-345-1273. Now, broadcasting from the WTMA studios, here's your host, Brian Beatty.
Good morning, Charleston. Welcome to the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show here on the Big Talker, 1250 WTMA and WTMA.com. We are live in the studio today taking your calls, talking about the housing market. Is the market going to crash? Is a question I'm getting a lot right now. We're going to cover that first this morning. But if you have a question, you have something you'd like to know about the housing market, feel free to give me a call here in the studio. The number is 843-556-1250. 843-556-1250 to be on the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show. Ask your real estate-based questions, here to help, here to be a resource. If this is your first time tuning into the show, this is where we talk about the housing market. We talk about real estate. I've been a real estate agent for over 15 years now. I've been in the top 1% of agents in our market since 2009, every year since. About 1,100 homes sold in that time frame. So I share my experiences with you as somebody that's, you know, in the market, both as a real estate agent and as a real estate team owner and as an investor and, of course, radio show host, just to help you guys better understand what's happening in our market. And you know, one of the questions I'm getting a lot right now is, you know, are we about to pay the piper? Is this market kind of on the brink of collapse? What's gonna happen here in the fourth quarter of this year, the first quarter of next year? And obviously, I'm not an economist, but I'm well-read and I understand the topic a lot better than the vast majority of folks that hold a real estate license. So we're going to talk about that this morning. But again, if you have a question, the number to be on the program is 843-556-1250. Now, if you want to reach out to me personally and you want to talk about your interest in buying, selling, or investing in real estate, we're happy to help. We have a real estate team, and I, of course, am still personally in production. Unlike many team leaders that you see out there, I actually do still sell real estate, believe it or not. I'm not just the name on the sign. So you can give me a call. My cell phone number is 843-400-8009. That's 843-400-8009. Or go to my website, listingsincharleston.com. So in order to, I guess, answer the question of are we on the brink of collapse, so to speak, of course, you're always going to have some folks that think everything is fine and, you know, we'll figure it out when we get to it. And then you've got, of course, the people that are just the doom and gloomers that are like, nope, things are going down. I mean, it doesn't matter how good things are. They're always looking at when, not if, but when things are going to get bad. That's just their view of the world. And we need those folks. You know, we need the devil's advocates in life. But I think most people right now are cautiously optimistic about our specific area of the country as it relates to the housing market. But what I want to talk about first is just kind of this broader picture of what's happening. What should we be looking for? What are some of the signs that we're going to start to see that help us better understand whether we are, you know, on the brink of a crash or not? And so let's talk about what happened kind of leading up to the crash of 2008. If you look at, you know, 2000 to 2005, you know, first of all, home values between 2000 and 2005 went up 50% in a five-year period. That is huge. That is just a ton of new equity. That's a lot of new wealth for people that they're just not used to having. You also look at the fact that 40% of homes were purchased as either investments or second homes. So, you know, when things are going really well, there's going to be speculation in the market. And really what kind of happens, the turning point, the thing that kind of accelerates everything is the fact that a home becomes an investment, no longer just a home. In other words, a house becomes an investment, something that's always going to go up. And so that then leads to investor speculation. It leads to folks thinking, well, hey, I'll buy now and, you know, a few years from now, we'll sell it, we'll make $100,000. We'll take that money and we'll bank it, or, you know, actually you wish that that was the reasonable approach that a lot of people had back then. But, in fact, it was the complete opposite. It was, hey, we've just made $100,000, time to get that nice boat, or go on a great trip, or, you know, do something. A lot of that money got spent, as we know. So in anyways, you know, investors start to speculate. It pushes up values in the area, especially some of these areas, some of these neighborhoods where, you know, homes haven't been renovated in a while. It's areas that are really ripe for opportunity to flip property, you know, the entry-level pricing homes. So investors will swoop in. They'll start to target a bunch of these homes that now have equity. Seller gets a payout. The investor comes in and they create value through renovation. They sell for profit by flipping the real estate. But really what it does is it pushes a large portion of that population out of that area. They can't afford to buy a home in that neighborhood anymore because values have gone up. And so it causes people to say, you know what, hey, I might as well cash out. You know, I've got equity, time to go. And so, of course, you know, again, it just it pushes out buyers. And, you know, you look at things like real estate investment trusts, which are, you know, one portion of that. You also have large investors that are well-known in different areas that will absorb inventory. But then you have some institutional investors that will come in, like American Homes for Rent and, you know, a few other different types of companies. And they're just out there and they're looking for deals. If they can flip it, they'll flip it. If they can rent it, they'll rent it. But they just want to buy and hold real estate. But then you also have people that are doing ARMs, you know, adjustable rate mortgages, thinking, hey, you know what? I'll just refi in 2 years at a really great, quote unquote, introductory rate, pull out my cash. And that's when homes become ATMs. And that's what got a lot of people into trouble. And so you've got, you know, these attractive rates. Anybody can get a mortgage right now. You can do a stated income, stated asset mortgage. And then these mortgages, by the way, are being packaged up and sold as CDOs, initially at least, collateralized debt obligations, which had a AAA rating. You know, if you guys want more information on what led to the 2008 crash, just do yourself a favor and watch or read The Big Short. Fantastic movie, fantastic book. Goes into great detail. Excellent story about how we got to where we were in 2008 and then, you know, kind of what happened after that. So The Big Short, great movie, great book. So, you know, now you've got people that are living large. You know, they're living the life. And they were also saying that close to 50% of GDP was a result of the wealth that was created in the housing market between, say, 2000 and 2006. So then what happens? Well, then crisis hits. 2008 hits. And so you fast forward to now, and it's not the, you know, the housing crash. It's, we've got a pandemic. You know, we've got a virus that has had a massive economic impact on people in our country. You know, we've got markets that are now, you know, markets are shaped by unemployment and consumer confidence and interest rates and, of course, supply and demand. And so we've got unemployment to be aware of, but we've also had government, you know, take some pretty massive action to attempt to prevent economic collapse. And a lot of people are concerned that, you know, come November, who knows what their stance on this is going to be. But what's happened is we've had a lot of people that have had the ability to kind of kick the can down the road, either by remaining, you know, remaining furloughed or doing something like a mortgage forbearance. A lot of companies have taken out PPP funds and EIDL funds. And if and when they need to make those payments, if they don't have the ability to, if business hasn't gotten better, if the business hasn't gotten back into a position where, you know, they're light on their feet and they can afford to make those payments, then, you know, what's a reasonable assumption for that business owner? That they're going to pull that money from somewhere. Well, where can they go where there's a pretty substantial amount of money right now that they could have somewhat easy access to? Well, it's equity in their homes. They don't have a home. They don't have an income if they don't have a business. So sometimes they need to do what they need to do to keep their business afloat. So this is where things start to get obviously a little bit hairy. So you can kind of guess what happens next. So in other words, you know, government, they come in, they try to fix it. Interest rates are slashed. I literally refinanced my house yesterday at a 2.99% interest rate. Cha-ching. Awesome. If you guys have not looked into refinancing, if you don't even know what your interest rate is, you got to get on that. Really. There's no reason why you shouldn't go out there and save some money on your mortgage. Take a look at it. I've got plenty of folks that you can call. My lenders are incredible. They really do offer a fantastic experience. So anyways, kind of finishing this thought out. So 2008 hits, government does a few things. They slash interest rates. They've remained incredibly low, which stimulates the economy. Then you've got things like, you know, quantitative easing, which basically, you know, buys back enough time for these businesses or financial institutions to get back on their feet if we don't have to bail them out entirely, by the way. And, you know, it's not a bad gig, really, when you think about it. You know, whenever things get bad, we just create some money out of thin air and then loan it out with some interest. You know, but that's, you know, that's what our government has the ability to do, because as of right now, we are still the currency that people want to invest in. So why aren't we seeing or hearing more about the housing market crash? We're going to talk about that when we come back. I'm going to give you some things that you should be watching for, listening for, and of course that I'm going to report and continue to do so on the radio. But if you have questions, remember the number here in the studio if you want to call and have a chat about the market is 843-556-1250, 843-556-1250. Stick around for more of the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show on the Big Talker 1250 WTMA.
Find Brian Beatty online at listingsincharleston.com. The Brian Beatty Real Estate Show continues next on the Big Talker 1250 WTMA.
1250 WTMA.
Expert news and views on the Lowcountry real estate scene. The Brian Beatty Real Estate Show on 1250 WTMA.
Welcome back, folks, to the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show here on the Big Talker, 1250 WTMA and WTMA.com. If you want to be on the program, you have a question, something you'd like more information on, you want to just share your opinion, the number here in the studio is 843-556-1250, 843-556-1250. Now, if you want to reach out to me personally, you've got a question or you're interested in buying or selling real estate, you want to invest in real estate, you just want to have a conversation about the process or have a question that you just want to have answered off air, feel free to give me a call. My number, my cell phone number is 843-400-8009. That's 843-400-8009. Or you can always go online. Listingsincharleston.com is our website. Listingsincharleston.com. Learn more about my team and who we are and what we do, what we sell, how we sell it. Listen to, gosh, hundreds of shows that I've done here on WTMA. All that great stuff on listingsincharleston.com. So we're talking about the housing market. Is it going to crash? Is a bubble forming? Has it already formed? Is it about to burst? What's going to happen? What are the predictions? And I tell you, one of the really interesting ways to kind of gauge consumer confidence is to just basically do Google searches and then figure out what comes up first. You know, so if you just go to Google and you type in real estate market data, you know, almost every single time, one of the things that you'll see is the housing market about to crash? And we're going to take a quick break on that topic, and we're going to switch over to the phones. We're going to go to Tim in Mount Pleasant. Tim, how are you this morning?
Doing great, man. I can tell you from the appraiser's perspective that there's no crash in sight. We're burning it up. It's crazy. But I just recently heard that Governor McMaster said had applied for a FEMA loan for small business support, which is how President Trump got money going around Congress because they couldn't come with a deal. I was just wondering if you knew anything about it or if anybody had any additional information on it and when that money might be available and how to apply for it.
You know, I don't know. But whenever I have questions like that, I have a go-to guy that I always call. That's a great resource for me. I'll tell you what, when we hang up, when we're off air, next break, I'll send you his contact info.
All right.
He's the guy that I go to for stuff like that.
I figured you'd have a guy.
I got a guy.
You got a guy for everybody, don't you?
I try to surround myself with people that are smarter than I am, and that means there's a lot of them.
the mastermind process. Absolutely, man. All right. Appreciate the show.
Hey, you betcha. Take care.
All right. Bye.
All right. So, you know, we're talking about, hey, you know, is a crash imminent? It's I want to address the concern because obviously people have it. It's a real concern for them. Would I say, is it halting consumer behavior right now? Is it causing people not to buy or sell real estate? That has not been my experience. I think it's really interesting to talk about. I think it's really interesting to plan for. I think you need to have knowledge like this when you're making big decisions in life. But why aren't we, you know, what's going on right now, really? I mean, what's happening? I mean, the reality is this. Interest rates are ridiculously low, and they're going to stay there because why would they go up? Why would we shoot ourselves in the foot? It's just not going to happen. And I don't mind drawing my line in the sand on that particular prediction because a big interest rate hike is just going to kill the economy. And we tried it before the pandemic when interest rates temporarily went up to 4.25%, 4.5%, and then it was, you know, doom and gloom, the sky is falling for a few months. So I don't see that happening. I am concerned about a lot of folks that have taken forbearances, essentially kicked the can down the road 4 months, because it's not a delay in... Really, all it means is that 4 months from the beginning of that forbearance, you got to pay one big check. So you get 4 months of no payments, 120 days, but then it's all due at once. And so a lot of people that have been furloughed or laid off or that are just a little tough on times right now will take the forbearance, hope that things get better. And if they don't, and if they haven't accounted for that, and they can't write that check, then that's what, for some people, is going to start this spiral. That's going to be the point in which people say, you know what, okay, it doesn't seem like things are going to get that much better for us economically, at least in the short term. And I don't want to miss too many payments. I don't want my credit score to get negatively impacted. You know, I can still go and maybe buy something somewhere else, or I at least have equity. It's time to cash out. We haven't started that phase in this process yet. There is no, you know, consistent panic selling happening in our market. Now, I will say this. I've had plenty of people call me that have said, you know what, we want to go ahead and sell it now. We don't have to sell, but we want to sell now because we want to do this before things start to get crazy. We see the writing on the wall. And I'll tell you, one of the great things about being, you know, in my position, being in my industry, doing what I do for a living, is that I am exposed to all walks of life, you know, all different kinds of people and all different sectors of the economy. All of, you know, very much so having different opinions on what's going to happen here. You know, I've represented some folks that are, you know, anything from nurses to surgeons over the past few months. And it's incredibly interesting to talk to them about their view on the coronavirus as opposed to, you know, what you might hear or watch on TV, if that's your only outlet of information. So we haven't begun this process yet of you know, panic selling. Interest rates, I don't think, are going to go anywhere anytime soon. The only other thing to really talk about is inventory. And right now, you know, when I checked yesterday, when I looked at the MLS, we had like 3,400 properties available. I mean, we are down in a ridiculous number of homes from this time last year. Usually, this is when inventory kind of peaks on an annual, on a, you know, seasonal basis. You know, we've got March that signifies the month in which people really start to put their homes on the market. They're preparing for that move early summer. So they get it on the market in March, a little bit more in April. Properties start to go under contract April, May, June, but we've got the inventory to support it. And then things tend to slow down a little bit in the fall. And then, of course, they take a little bit more of a break in the winter. That's the seasonality of our market. Well, except for this year, instead of new listings going up starting in April, they started going down. And we've also put more homes under contract in a single month than we have in any other month in the history of our market. We've actually broken that record twice. 15 of the last 16 or so weeks, we've had more homes be put under contract than we have in any other week in like 2018. We continue to break all these records. We've broken, what, the interest rate record 9 times already this year? So you've got all these great things happening in the market right now. So let's talk a little bit more about the process of, you know, what you go through when you consider buying, selling, or investing in real estate. We'll do that when we come back. More of the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show here in a few minutes. Again, if you want to be on the program, 843-556-1250, 843-556-1250. Stick around, folks. We'll be right back.
Stay tuned for more of the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show on 1250 WTMA and WTMA.com.
1250 WTMA.
Now, here's more of the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show on the Big Talker, 1250 WTMA.
Welcome back, folks, to the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show here on the Big Talker, 1250 WTMA. I always like to take a little bit of time and just say thank you to those of you that listen to this program and rely on the information within it to better understand the housing market, to gain an understanding of what you should expect. What are some of the questions that you should be asking as you approach the process of buying, selling, or investing in real estate? So thank you to those of you that reach out. Always love helping a fellow radio show listener, whether it be just something simple that I can help you with, share a contact or a resource that I have, or of course to work with you to help you buy, sell, or invest in real estate. So if you want to reach out to me and have that conversation, if you want to just chat about your plans, what you're thinking, start to put some of these, you know, things into motion, my number is 843-400-8009. That's 843-400-8009. Or you can visit me online, listingsincharleston.com. That's listingsincharleston.com. Now, if you want to be on the program, we've got about, 30 minutes left. If you have questions, if you have anything you want to know real estate related, it doesn't have to be about the topic that we're, you know, currently talking about. Any question you have at all, feel free to call and we can chat about it. 843-556-1250 is the number here in the studio. 843-556-1250. So we were talking about, you know, we've kind of gone back in time and we looked at the things that led up to the crash of 2008. What happened after 2008? What should we be looking at now? Is the market going to crash anytime soon? Gosh, I'll tell you, there are a lot of opinions on this, and they're pretty radical in both directions. And so you look at some of the valid points that they make, and it's reasonable to believe that a correction is coming. I mean, at some point, we're going to have to deal with the fact that we've been kicking the can down the road. We're going to have to accept and acknowledge the fact that a lot of small businesses are really struggling right now. And a lot of the people that own those small businesses, of course, own real estate. They have employees. There's a lot of spinoff that occurs as a result of that. So then you've got layoffs. You've got unemployment going on right now that we need to still, of course, be aware of. It's getting better, but that's going to lead to people putting their homes on the market. We're just not there yet. And it's tough to say when we will be. But the reality is our inventory is incredibly low. You know, as we were taking a break, I wanted to pull up the MLS and I wanted to see this morning how many homes are on the market. And here we go. 3,488 properties available on the market right now. It's pretty incredible. I mean, if you look at the entire MLS, you know, all property types, single family, condos, townhomes, manufactured homes, all, you know, new construction, you know, existing inventory. If we look at the number of homes available for sale, you know, again, we're 3,488 right now. This time last year, we were at 6,300. Pretty big drop. Unbelievable drop. Let's be real. That is a huge drop. We were at 2.5 months supply of inventory at the end of July, and it's down even more than that here with, you know, what, just a little bit of time left here in August. Obviously, those stats haven't come out yet. These are monthly stats that I'm reading, but August is not going to look any better than July. But it also depends on, you know, through what lens or according to who. For a seller, man, you guys have an incredible opportunity right now to sell something and buy with a just ridiculously low interest rate. I mean, that is a financial incentive to move. And, you know, all these folks that we talk to, well, not all these folks we talk to, but a lot of the people that we speak with say, you know, hey, we don't have to sell. We're not going to, quote unquote, give our house away. I mean, we hear that all the time. Hey, you know, Brian, we don't have to sell. We're not going to give our house away. Very rarely do I ask somebody to just give their house away. Can we just get that out there first? I've never asked anybody to give their house away. I want to sell their home for as much money as they can get. But I also want to be realistic about their situation. You know, if they have to sell and they have to sell now, then we're going to price that home accordingly. If they don't have to sell, but they would like to sell, well, then we're going to choose a price that's going to cause the house to sell, not to sit. And so these folks that we're helping that are getting multiple offers on their house that are, just, I mean, the market for sellers is so strong right now that it's tough to, you know, really anticipate things getting much better for a seller, really, or for a buyer. I mean, yeah, of course, prices could come down as a buyer, which would create a lower monthly payment. But by the time prices start to go down drastically enough for it to really move the needle for you and the payment that is associated with the ownership of the house, then we're going to have bigger issues to deal with. I think you take advantage of the really cheap money right now, which is the, you know, we've gotten people interest rates at like 2.75%. I mean, it's just absurd how low the interest rate is. And you guys know that it's not going to stick around. I mean, It just can't. So what are people doing right now that are thinking about selling? I'll tell you one of the things that we find to be really true right now is that a lot of people are just weighing their options as to whether they stay in their current home or they go ahead and they sell and they figure out another solution. Because think about this. People have been in their homes. It's where they're working. It's where they're playing. They're, you know, very rarely getting out from their house. So they've got a really good pulse on whether that house works for them or not, whether it's going to work for them long-term or not. Got a lot of folks that are thinking, you know, hey, let's start a family or let's grow our family. Or you know what? The kids are getting older. They've got a year or so left in high school. Or maybe they just graduated high school, whatever the case might be. We don't need all this space. Let's get some of this cash in the bank, fund the retirement account, or pay for college or do whatever with it. And let's simplify. We don't need this much space. I don't want to maintain 4,000 square feet if it's going to be just us the majority of the time. Let's find something a little more manageable. Let's go travel. Let's do something, you know, assuming you can start to travel. So as they're going through this and as they're kind of discovering that, you know, hey, it makes sense. It makes sense for me to sell right now, so long as I can find what I'm looking for. Then one of the things they'll do is they'll say, okay, well, what do we need to do this place to get it ready for sale? Or if we're going to stay here and we're going to renovate, what does that look like? What should we do? Do we really go all out and pull out a home equity line of credit and, you know, make this place incredible? Or does it make sense just to do some small repairs, sell this place and move on? And so one of the things that we created, because we'd been doing it for a long time, years and years and years, is to help people renovate their home to sell it. I mean, I've been involved in well over 100 flips, both personally and through my assistance with other real estate investors. So when we walk into a house, and you know, I'll also say this, and I'm not, you know, boasting, but I've spent millions of dollars of my own money on renovations in renovating real estate. I know how much things cost. I've seen, I can't tell you how many home inspection reports and repair requests and quotes for all those things. I mean, I got a good grasp on how much things cost here. So when we walk into a house and someone says, well, we're thinking about doing this and we're doing that, and we've already got a guy contracted to do this and do that, I would really love it if I could just at some time say, before you go through all of that, before you start to have contractors over, before you make decisions, before you put down payments down, just call us. let us provide you with our opinion. Let us tell you what's going to help your home to sell, what's going to add value, and then what you should just save your time and energy and money on, because it's not going to matter to that buyer. The market is so strong in some areas that, yes, you can get away with not doing certain things to your home. If you don't have a really good pulse on the market, you're not going to know what those things are. Now, you've also got plenty of buyers right now that say, you know what, I don't have time to do renovations. I don't have time for that. I'm willing to pay a premium for the home that already has those things done to it. So now you, the seller, need to ask yourselves, is that going to be me? Am I going to do that? Am I going to cash in on that? Or am I okay with making less money on my house if I leave that project to another buyer? So what we'll do is we'll walk through the house and we'll talk about a budget. And we'll say, all right, well, based on that, this is what I would do first, and then second, and then third. These are the things that you can do. These are the things you should not do because they don't matter. We'll let the buyer deal with those things. Here are the folks that we use for those types of projects. And that's kind of like the typical process. You know, we'll have these homeowners do a few small things to their house. Sometimes it doesn't cost any more than a few $100s. Sometimes it's a few $1,000s. But we're also going to help them get set up so that we understand what some of these issues are a little bit later on down the road once they're under contract. One of them being a free pre-listing home inspection. You know, when was the last time you crawled underneath your house? Probably been a while. And I'll tell you, this time of year, it's very wet. It's very humid. If you're on a crawl space, chances are there's something wrong in your crawl space. Just the majority of the inspection reports we get, especially this time of year, have some sort of issue going on in your crawl space. So we want to figure out what those things are. We want to prepare for that. We want to have a budget in mind for that. We would like to get quotes from people, regardless of whether we have the money to fix it or not. We just want to know how much it's going to cost so that if we're, you know, under contract and the buyer gets their home inspection and they uncover that issue and they say, oh my gosh, that's going to cost $10,000 to fix. We can say, no, it's going to cost $2,800 because here's a quote from two different people, one for $2,500, one for $3,000. We'll give you the benefit of the doubt. It's going to cost $2,800. You've already researched that. Those are some of the ways that we save people massive amounts of money. Because think about it. A buyer's contractor is not going to do you, the homeowner, any favors if they know that you're the one foot in the bill. So we go through this process. We better understand how much things are going to cost. We provide that analysis to that homeowner and we say, here's how much your home is worth right now. If you were to do some things to your property, here are the different scales at which you can do those things. Here's how much those things are going to cost. But then here is the value that you get in return. And people really like having an understanding of that so that they can kind of pick and choose. And plus, you know, for some people, it's kind of fun doing some of that work. I know that sounds a little crazy. But let's be honest, all of us, you know, are kind of looking for things to do. So, a lot of people have been doing some projects around the house. And you know, if you're thinking about selling, believe me, I can give you several. We'll also have a professional designer and decorator walk through the house and give you an idea of, you know, here's what you can be doing right now. Here's how you can stage your home. Here's some things that you can add. Here's some things that you should declutter. You know, take this couch and move it over here. Remove that piece of art, so on and so forth. And so you just, you know, by the time they're done, you walk away with a long list of things room by room that you can and should not do to prepare your home to be sold. We offer all those things at no cost. So if you'd like to learn more about working with my real estate team and some of the incentives that we provide to help you sell your house, feel free to give me a call. 843-400-8009 is my cell phone number, 843-400-8009, or you can go online to listingsincharleston.com. That's listingsincharleston.com. Learn more about our team. Get an instant offer on your house. Learn more about the value of your home. If you want to sell it on your own, we have resources for that. And of course, a bunch of different versions of this show, a few hundred at this point. So listingsincharleston.com is the website. Stick around, folks, for more of the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show here in just a few minutes on the Big Talker 1250 WTMA and WTMA.com.
It's the- the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show. Broadcast Saturday mornings at 9 and Sunday mornings at 10 on the Big Talker 1250 WTMA.
1250 WTMA, the Big Talker.
You're listening to the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show on the Big Talker 1250 WTMA and WTMA.com.
Welcome back, folks, to the last few minutes of the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show here on the Big Talker, 1250 WTMA and WTMA.com. Remember, if you want to reach out to me personally and talk about your interest in buying, selling, or investing in real estate, my number is 843-400-8009. That's 843-400-8009. Or go to listingsincharleston.com, listingsincharleston.com. Now, we've got 10 minutes left in the program. If you want to be on it, feel free to give me a call, 843-556-1250. 843-556-1250 is the number here in the studio. So I want to finish our discussion this morning talking about investments, talking about flipping property more specifically, because this is kind of the natural progression that people go through is they see, hey, real estate market's doing really well. I've got some extra cash on hand. Should I pull some cash out of my house and go and start to flip some properties? I mean, I had one person that came to me earlier in the week and they said, you know, we've got a bunch of equity in our house. We're thinking about pulling it out and buying a rental property and doing some flips. And I asked them about their level of experience and we had, you know, a good consultation. And you know, they don't mind me talking about this, but the reality is they really just, they didn't understand, the costs involved with real estate investment. They didn't really understand the process. And that's why we met, you know, that's, we go through these things. I want them to have a really good understanding of what they're about to get themselves into rather than just be that real estate agent that says, hey, that's a great idea. Let's go find some homes to flip, you know, like here we go. So we had a really good conversation and I just want to go over some of the things that that I discussed with them that I think are going to be really helpful for you if you're thinking about getting into real estate flipping, because don't get me wrong, there's plenty of money to be made flipping real estate right now. I mean, I'm literally always on the hunt for a good deal. And that's frankly one of the benefits of being a real estate agent is that you get to be in the right place at the right time every once in a while. And you have these home run opportunities that come across your desk. Well, I can't buy every single one of them. So we look to investors to allow us to earn a commission and allow us to help them make some money so that we can earn some repeat clients and so that everybody's happy. So we were talking first about just the selection of properties. You know, where do we go? Where do we look for these things? Not how do we find them, because that could be an entire show on how to find these types of deals, which we are doing. But I'm going to save you the time because really we don't have it. About how we're finding these deals. But, you know, what are some of the things that we look for in a deal? Well, we look for an area that is stable. We look for an area in which properties are selling quickly. We're looking in areas where there's not an oversupply of real estate, where demand is high, where prices are going up. We're looking in emerging neighborhoods. We're looking for areas that are growing. And we're looking for areas, of course, that people want to be in. Right? Where there's just, there's always going to be an abundance of people that want to be in that area or close to it. Now, once we find it, here's what I'm noticing a lot of people are struggling with is they really just don't have a good grasp on the costs. The cost to acquire, the cost to hold, the cost to renovate, the cost to sell, the closing costs associated with all of this. If you don't know your numbers, then you don't have any business being in the flipping business, because what's going to happen is it's going to be a flop, not a flip. And then you're going to say, oh man, that was a big mistake. This is high risk. You know, if you're using your own money, it could end very poorly for you. So know your numbers, work with professionals that know their numbers. Don't over leverage yourself. You know, you can be really successful for a long time and still go broke if every rental is mortgaged to the hilt, or if you continue to rob Peter to pay Paul. You know, at some point in time, you're going to get caught. That's what happened to so many people in 2008. Think about all the contractors that became builders that started building spec homes that then saw this crash happen, and they've got three, four, five homes that they're in the process of building, that they can't sell. What did they do? Turned in the keys, hung it up, and went back to, you know, doing contractor work for folks, which was really sad. I know a lot of people that happened to. But, you know, you've got to do your homework on this stuff. You've got to interview people, assess their level of experience, assess how much risk tolerance you have, what sort of budget, of course, you're working with, and then come up with the process together. I mean, really, if somebody works with me, they want to look for an investment property, we already have the process. We'll plug them into our network. We'll find them the properties, so long as we know and have a general sense of some parameters to work within. You know, like, in other words, what is the return requirement that you have in order to say, yes, I want to flip that property? I mean, we'll do the work. We'll put the numbers together. But if we're going to do that, and if you say, hey, as long as I can get, if I can make $20,000 or if I can make 20% on a flip, you know, that's my minimum requirement. If I can do that, then I will buy it and I'll flip it. So long as it's not in an area that's, you know, off the beaten path, or it takes a huge amount of effort to renovate the property. I mean, all these different folks have these different caveats to that, of course. But if we can bring you a deal that accomplishes your goal, it should be a yes, because what you should be doing is removing the emotion from this decision and making a business decision, an investment decision. So leverage the experience of the experts that you put on your team that have been through this process before, that have spent their own money doing what they're advising you to do, that know the market, know where the opportunities are, you know, understand the budget and the timeline, and frankly, the fact that you're probably going to go over on both. That's just kind of how these things work, which is why you need to have a rainy day fund, and why you need to treat your investments, you know, like a business. And of course, count on, you know, vacancies and some of the things that, you know, like, nothing happens in a bubble or in a vacuum where, you know, everything goes according to plan. That's why when we're doing our analysis, like as an example, if we're going to buy a rental property, we account for the fact that it's going to be empty at some point in time throughout that year. We call it vacancy loss. So right now you might be able to say, hey, you know what? I'll plan on it being vacant for 1 month. But what happens when this market starts to turn? What if 1 month turns into two? What if 2 months turns into three? And now this property that was making you an 8% return on investment is barely breaking even because it's taking you longer to find tenants because the rental market got swarmed. That could be a little foreshadowing. If you want to read between the lines there, think about all the institutional investors that have bought property. You know, we don't have, you know, folks like Zillow or Offerpad or Knock, you know, these big institutional investment firms buying property in Charleston. But we have other institutional investors that are here that are buying property, that have been buying property here for years and years and years. They own hundreds, if not thousands, collectively of properties. What happens if those start to go on the market? And if they're okay with, you know, not squeezing every penny out of the deal, because it's not like that's what's funding their retirement. It's a quick business decision for them. We're going to get out. We're going to get that money into something else. So if you're thinking about flipping property, best I can tell you is to work with somebody that has done this before. It's one thing to find a deal. It's another to manage the project, stay on budget, stay on task, and then sell it and sell it for an amount of money that causes this whole investment to be worthwhile. So if that's something I can help you with, or if really you're just thinking about getting into real estate investing in any way, shape, or form, you want to buy a home, sell a home, feel free to give me a call, 843-400-8009. That's 843-400-8009. That's my personal cell. Or go online to our website, listingsincharleston.com. That's listingsincharleston.com. A lot of great information there. Thanks so much for listening to the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show this weekend on the Big Talker, 1250 WTMA and WTMA.com.
join us for another edition of the Brian Beatty Real Estate Show next Saturday morning at 9 and Sunday morning at 10. Contact Brian Beatty online at listingsincharleston.com. That's listingsincharleston.com. Or call him at 843-345-1273. 843-345-1273.